As always, we'll start with the latest developments of the SpaceX Starship at Boca Chica. Talking of SpaceX, as you know, ULA really isn't happy about their success. So what do they do, of course? They start playing dirty. Oh, this story is going to be brutal.
And of course, it's time to bash SLS again. Come on, we have held ourselves back for weeks now. Because Kathy Luders, the NASA Chief of Human Exploration and Operations, revealed in a blog post that SLS could be postponed even further. Oh, and of course SLS will cost more than originally estimated. What a surprise! Today it's Space Rant time again, so stay tuned.
So let's as always start with an overview of the latest developments at Boca Chica. Unfortunately, yesterday's SN6 hop event was scrubbed due to high wind speeds. Bummer. And it looks like the hop also won't take place today or tomorrow, since the road closures for these 2 days have been cancelled, as you can see here. Thus, we have the feeling that we can expect the next hop attempt with SN6 earliest again by the end of the week. Let's hope that this time the weather will play nice with us. Starship SN5 is meanwhile waiting already outside the mid-bay. It would be so cool to see SN5 hop again very soon after SN6. The Super Heavy high bay is continuing to grow, with some very brave people doing some work up there. Better not be afraid of heights for this job. And will soon reach its final height of 80 meters. This means also that work on the Super Heavy booster itself will begin soon, which has also been confirmed by Elon. He is of course again doing his Elon time thing in this tweet, saying that they will attempt a hop with Super Heavy already by October.
We believe that might be a bit too Elon timey, but we probably will get a new Starship update presentation by then, with new interesting information. But of course we hope that a Super Heavy prototype booster can still hop by the end of this year. Talking of Super Heavy, the insane launch mount for this behemoth booster is also progressing, as you can see in these as always amazing shots from Boca Chica Gal. Thanks a lot as always. Just imagine Super Heavy launching from this mount. We try but fail to imagine how insane it will be. Then another Starship test tank, the SN7.1, is already waiting for its cryo pressure test. This Starship prototype is based on 304L steel and will test the resilience of this new alloy and the welds, which are the most important part. It's thought that the welds will be much stronger with the new alloy. So there's a lot going on at Boca Chica, and we just have to be a bit more patient until we can see the next Starship hop.
Still on the topic of SpaceX, they now have secured the launch of Masten Space Systems' moon lander in 2022 as part of NASA's Commercial Lunar Payload Services program, or short CLPS. SpaceX will launch Masten's XL-1 lander here towards the moon, where it will set down near the lunar south polar region. As we remember, SpaceX will also deliver the first two modules of the Lunar Gateway station on a Falcon Heavy in 2023, and will also resupply said Lunar Gateway station afterwards with Falcon Heavy and the new Dragon XL spacecraft. And of course, we have SpaceX as the primary launch provider for NASA's manned missions to the ISS with Falcon 9 and Crew Dragon. The next mission, which will be the Crew 1 mission, will take off on the 23rd of October this year, and the Crew 2 mission is set for March 2021. So NASA is relying more and more on SpaceX, which is of course logical and makes economically the most sense.
Very much to the dismay of the good old lobby companies such as Boeing and Lockheed. Boeing is still trying to get its Starliner to fly, with the next unmanned mission planned for December 2020. And if they don't mess it up again, a first mission with astronauts to the ISS in 2021. Lockheed and Boeing are jointly working on the SLS and Orion launch system as we know. And they also formed the joint venture ULA. And you know that ULA doesn't really like SpaceX a lot, since as we saw, SpaceX takes more and more of the launch contracts away from ULA. What a coincidence that suddenly, out of nowhere, that some politicians start to propose anti-SpaceX laws. How convenient for ULA that while they are declining more and more, suddenly this cool Colorado Republican senator named Cory Gardner comes along and suggests to put SpaceX under scrutiny for possible ties to China. Senator Gardner told the Washington Examiner recently, quote, "I'm concerned that companies in China could come into the US, make a sweetheart deal, take sensitive information, take proprietary technologies, and use it to enrich their own space program, their own national security efforts in China." Now, anyone who is intelligent certainly has noticed. Okay, but what does that have to do with SpaceX? SpaceX doesn't have any contracts or ties to China in any way.
But before we answer that question, please consider subscribing to this channel, because this would tremendously help us to continue brutally exposing the shady business practices of corrupt companies such as Boeing or Lockheed. Subscribing is, by the way, completely free, and of course we'd be extremely thankful. Now, some senators, such as Gardner, say that since Elon is also the chief of Tesla, and Tesla has a huge factory in China, and now even gets a $1.4 billion worth of loan from Chinese state-owned banks, this could indirectly profit SpaceX. This is quite a stretch, of course. But that didn't stop a congressional Republican aide to say, "What is there to stop them from going to Musk directly and saying, we'll call your line of credit early unless you give us X, Y, or Z?" And there's no real clarity that there's any kind of mechanism that would stop that other than good behavior by an individual. Wow. Okay, but you still might say, so what? Politicians gone mad again. What's the big deal? Happens all the time. Classic. And by the way, as we see, this insane behavior is prevalent among both sides of the political spectrum, so it's not tied to a specific party. Dems and Reps both have their black sheep. But the highly interesting part is this here. Guess who strongly urged Senator Gardner to introduce the bill? Any guesses? Any guesses? Yes, you there in the third row, yes? That's right, ULA. And no, this is not a joke. When this came out, a Gardner aide had to say this: "That's just responsible vetting. But to say this is a rubber stamp of something ULA gave us, and it's a ULA SpaceX fight, reveals a lack of recognition of what the real issue is."
Really? So attacking an American company that has no ties to China whatsoever, just because the CEO has another company which has a factory in China which gets Chinese loans, is responsible vetting? Again, SpaceX has no ties to China in any way, and we highly doubt that the Chinese loan will be used for anything else than for the production of the Model Y at Tesla's Gigafactory in China. So here is our take. ULA is losing the fight. They are dying. They know that they are inferior to SpaceX in every way. They have the inferior rockets. They have the inferior technology. They have no innovation. They are losing the race, the market share. They are losing more and more launch contracts to SpaceX. They are a dead man walking, kept alive by government subsidies. And without the government keeping them alive, in a free market, they would have already died a long time ago. So what do? Of course, play dirty. Try to hinder SpaceX with every dirty trick they can. Try to persuade politicians, such as this Gardner guy, to bring out bills that would put SpaceX at a disadvantage. That is the last resort of a dying company. When companies, the same is by the way true for states, empires, or any other organizational structure, die, they get desperate and thus very aggressive. Any means to survive is now legitimized.
We know that ULA is corrupt and that their highest goal is to survive for a few more years. But we just don't understand the short-sightedness and, frankly, stupidity of some politicians. They think they do the US a favor, but by actively hindering SpaceX, they actually do the US a gigantic disfavor. Because SpaceX will have the funds, thanks to Starlink, to act completely independent from the US. With their floating sea platforms, they will be able to launch Starship missions from anywhere they want. They will land on the moon, if it has to be, without NASA. They will land on Mars, if it has to be, without NASA. Thus, by hindering SpaceX, those politicians effectively hurt the US. It's just brutal to watch. It really hurts to watch this stuff. Okay, now let's fast switch to a topic that is not quite as aggressive. SLS. The same corrupt companies that want to hinder SpaceX want to continue building their insanely overpriced and outdated SLS, also known as Senate Launch System.
So Kathy Luthers, the current chief of human spaceflight at NASA. Let's see for how long. Because they just keep coming and going faster than we can say SLS, wrote in a recent blog post, link in the video description. Quote, while it's too early to predict the full impact of the pandemic, we are confident a November 2021 date is achievable with the recent pace of progress, and a successful green run hot fire test will enable us to better predict our target launch date for the mission. Confident a November 2021 launch is possible. Better predict a target launch date. That's so funny, if it wasn't so sad. Please remember that the first launch of SLS should have taken place already in 2017. And only a few months ago, the launch has been postponed by a full year, from late 2020 to late 2021. We wouldn't be surprised if it would slip to 2022, because Kathy Luther's wording is already such that it allows for further delays. And hey, what is 1 year more for this monstrosity called SLS, which has been under development since 2010, never flew, and already cost over $17 billion. Yes, that's right, never flew, already cost over $17 billion, and will cost at least $1.3 billion more until it can fly. And Luthers wrote that it could cost even more, 30% more actually than originally estimated, until the first flight of SLS. What a surprise! Imagine what SpaceX could have done with that amount of money.
But don't be sad, because we won't let the episode end on such a down note, of course. Because SpaceX will win in the end. Despite ULA's desperate tries to hinder SpaceX, despite the monstrosity of SLS, despite short-sighted politicians, SpaceX will win in the end with Starship. Why? Two words. Technological superiority. Oh, and the extremely high funds from Starlink should also help. Oh, and the independence from any national state with launches from the sea should also help. Oh, and this baby here, which will cost 1,000 times less than SLS and be much, much more capable. These things will see our dreams of humanity becoming a spacefaring civilization be fulfilled. And people like Gardner and companies like ULA will in 100 years not even be remembered as a footnote of history. It will be Elon Musk, SpaceX, and Starship that will be remembered for generations to come. And if you want to see us bash Blue Origin and their tiny moon lander compared to Starship, you can watch this video here.
It's a good one. So thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say, on to the future. Test, test, the famous test.
Wir sind voll dabei. Wir haben richtig viel Spaß.